me right up here after service. Come on up to the front, and if you got an application to turn in, also bring it. If you need one, we've got those too. So I'll tell you, we're gonna say our morning pledge this morning, and I'm excited to get to Jeb. Who's excited to get to Jeb? And I'm ready for him to knock us out. Amen. I'm ready for him to deliver the knockout punch to hell today, and just lift our spirits higher. And I believe that he will. And I'm just going to tell a story. We're going to talk. I'm going to do a little bit of an interview process, taking through all sorts of things that he's been through. And I believe just you hearing his words, I think something's going to shock you, something's going to amaze you, but all of it is going to bring you closer to Jesus. And that's his goal in life, is to use everything that he does and has been through and where he's going to bring people to Christ. He says, Pastor, everything on the platform, everything, to tell people about Jesus. Isn't that amazing? That's a man after my own heart. So stand up on your feet. Let's say our pledge gets us ready to receive this awesome morning of ministry. If you're visiting, you're welcome to stay long. Say it loudly. Help me out. I'm a Christian. That means I'm a Christ follower. It doesn't mean that I'm perfect or better than the person next to me. It just means that I'm forgiven, I'm loved, and I'm trying to be more like Christ today than I was yesterday. I don't have all the answers, but I do know the important ones. What are they? That God loves me, that I love God, that I'm blessed beyond measure, victorious, and I'm on my way to heaven. And I'm here today to learn more about the one who gives me life, and life more abundantly, so help me God. Amen. We're going to talk about Jesus today, amen? We're going to talk about Jesus today, stay standing, we're going to dismiss our young people to go off to the beach. And if you got a kindergarten to sixth grade, they're welcome to go over and enjoy our teacher over there. I think Janet's teaching this morning, and they're going to have an awesome time. They got great videos and all sorts of things, an incredible curriculum. And then while you're standing, I want to read you something, and then we're gonna pray over our service. I found this, and I thought it was kind of cute. A man called his physician, and he asked about blood pressure medication that he had prescribed. And the man said, "You did tell me that I would have to take this blood pressure medication for the rest of my life, right?" "Yes," the doctor answered, "I'm afraid you will." There was a moment of silence before the man hesitantly responded, then "could you tell me exactly how serious this blood pressure thing is?" The doctor was a bit confused by the man's question and the tone of his question. He asked, "Why do you ask?" "Because," the man explained, "the prescription on this bottle says no refills." You ever feel like your life is like that? Like you're on no refill in your life? You ever feel like that sometimes? No, you need your marriage refilled, and you think, "Man, I think there's no refill on this marriage." Your job, you feel like your dreams are at the end. You feel like, there's no refill. Your hope, how is my hope going to get refilled? I feel like I got no refill on my hope. Well, I'll tell you what, God has more than enough to fill your life to overflowing. You know, God doesn't just fill you to the top, but he fills you until you overflow. And you overflow, and you overflow. Isn't that beautiful? Amen. It's the greatest thing in the world. So let's pray for a great service. God, we come to you. Bob, bring me up just a hair, because my voice is struggling a bit. But God, we come to you in Jesus' name. We thank you for this beautiful morning that you've designed. God, you're the great creator, the great designer. God, you've decorated today with your love and your grace and your mercy and your goodness. You put together a beautiful story for this Sunday morning here at One Church Scottsdale. You wrote every line. You wrote every life, God. You wrote every situation. You know the beginning of it, the middle of it, and the end of it. And I pray, God, that you would have your way here, that you'd open up these people's lives, God. My life, open us all up today. Open up our diary and speak directly into our lives exactly what it is you want us to hear. You need us to hear, God. We know you always want it, but you need us to hear it. And may our hearts be open. Tell God this morning, "God, let my heart be open for you to do whatever you want to do in my heart today." And we pray that you anoint everything that happens, Jeff and me and the message and the communication and the time. And I'll tell you, every person here, I just thank you for the wonderful flow of your spirit in this place, and do something beautiful and new. May people leave today saying, "I'll never be the same again." Amen. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Turn to the person next to you and say, "You are so good looking." And you may be seated. We did this beautiful video about, and I know you've seen it already the last 2 weeks. I actually had somebody tell me the other day, "Now, how much longer does the Contender series go?" And I said, "Sunday." They said, "What? It's over?" And I said, "Yes." Oh, they were so upset it was over. So we got a brand new series starting about the showdown at the OK Corral. Pray for me tomorrow. We're going to shoot a brand new video. My wife will tell you that our front room is full of holsters and cowboy vests and cowboy hats and I got spurs and they jingle, jangle, jingle, amen. But we're gonna have a great time. And pray for me this week when we get this video done and my body's got all the energy and the spirit that I need to do it. But we're gonna watch this video one last time. Brian, you all ready? Let's try it. Let's watch the Contender.
I didn't plan on this. Nobody ever tells you how difficult life will really be. I mean, I didn't even see it coming.
Thank you, Pastor, for giving me this opportunity to stand before his people. They don't want to say that to all of you who sit here, man, that you guys are in the right place at the right time. Because God has something special for you today.
Amen. There's something special. Go ahead, you hold on to that. I got this. Jeb, it's tell me what year were you the boxing world champion? What year?
The world title in 1997.
In 1997. Incredible. And it was a long road to get there, wasn't it?
Most definitely.
Where were you born?
I was born in a small town called St. Martinville, Louisiana.
St. Martinville, Louisiana. Yes. We got another guy from Louisiana in here. Where is he? Well, there he is. There's where he is. And absolutely. And tell me about your family. You grew up with your family?
Yep. We're like eight in the family. Four sisters and three other brothers.
Okay.
Raised with my mother, single mother.
Yes.
And it's funny how I started boxing because my mom didn't want me to box at all. And one summer, I think it was in the 10th grade, me and my friends was walking around. They normally have summer jobs for students in high school, but that summer they didn't have no jobs. So me and my friend was walking, and we saw a guy building, fixing on a facility. And so we stopped and asked him, said, "Hey sir, do you need some help? We're looking for a summer job." So the guy said, "I'm fixing up, putting together a boxing team. If you guys decide to, if you guys come box, once you guys give me a job, I'll give you guys a job." Right. So I was like, "Hey, man, I'll come box. I need a job."
That's right.
I'm 15, I want to work.
You've been fighting a little bit already, haven't you?
Most definitely. Yeah. I mean, I've gotten in so many fights up in, you know, until 15 was unbelievable.
Yes.
When I was 15 years old, I've gotten in so many fights within the system. Louisiana. My freshman year in high school, I went to court that summer, and the juvenile court, has sentenced me to 4 years in reform school.
4 years.
4 years.
4 years.
As a freshman.
As a freshman.
And so when I went to court, the judge said, "Well, today's your lucky day. The reform school facility is filled up." And I'm like, "Yes, yes." So, I'm thinking I'm off the hook. I'm off the hook, so I guess they told my mom, "We'll come get Junior when the facility, when they have space."
Yeah.
So all summer long, I'm hanging out with my friends. I turned the corner. I stopped fighting, stopped getting in trouble. And so, because I got scared,
during
the first 4 years. So it's the first day of school, as a freshman, 7 o'clock in the morning, I get a knock on the door. It's the Louisiana State Troopers. We come to get Junior Butler. There's room for you at the junior home.
First day of school. Before school, they came to
knock
on the door.
And so, and I was so excited, because I just got introduced to football. And I was so excited about playing football as a freshman in high school. So my mom crying, my sister and brother's crying. I drive off 2-3 hours to a foreign school.
What'd you think at that time?
And you know what? I didn't really have no thought, Pastor.
Yeah.
Didn't think about nothing. I did think about, you know, God, I lived my whole 4 years. 4 years, I won't be able to go to high school as my freshman, sophomore, junior, senior.
Yeah.
I'll be done with it. I won't get it, you know, have that high school experience.
Yeah.
And so, and that was the thought. The thought was only for a second.
Yeah.
And I kept on thinking, just kept on going. But when I got to reform school, because I fought prior to going there, the guard, the DOC guard at the juvenile home, he had recognized me from some article that he read in the paper that summer. That I won the Golden Glove, how good I was.
You won the Golden Gloves, boxing.
And my first fight.
Yeah.
First fight ever. And so the guy said, "Oh man, don't I know you? Go ahead." And he was like, "Yes, your name is Gene Butler." I said, "Yes, I am." I said, "That's me." "Man, you just fought New Orleans. You won the Golden Glove. I watched you fight." And so because of the big shebang you made in the juvenile home, all those guys at the juvenile home, you know, wanted to fight me.
Wanted to fight me.
"Oh, I can beat him.
Yes.
That's what the guy was like, "You know, Gene, don't get in trouble, man. You know, you got 4 years. If you get in trouble, you're gonna stay in here longer." And so it was my 30th day. On the 30th day of reform school.
30th day.
In reform school. I'm sitting down on my bed. I hear my name on the intercom. "Junior Butler, you going home?" So I get up, I run down, I say, "Well, I'm going home. I got 4 years, it's 30 days." He got the man, "You're good behavior. You let me go because you're good
behavior."
Yes, man. So he said, "Man, we let you go home." we let him go home. And so one of the guys that was in form school with me, who didn't like the guard giving me all the praise while I was in there because I boxed, he slided me, he hit me and ran.
Oh.
And I was running after him. The guard said, "Junior, you want to stay or you want to leave?"
That's right.
And so I said, "Okay, I'll leave. I'll leave.
God choose your battle,
yep,
right?"
Yep, yep. And so I went home. My mom was so happy. My family was so happy. But I was able to get in high school. I started as a freshman in high school, continued my education, got in the band, played sports, played football. And come to find out, though, the boxing gym that I started boxing in that summer closed down. There was no boxing gym. My mom didn't have a car, my sister and brother, nobody had a car. So I had to drive to the next city. So because I had a passion and desire to become a world champion, I got introduced to world champions in New Orleans. When I went boxing at one time, I was like, I want to be a world champion.
Yeah.
And so I never let that never let that left me.
Now they hear a lot of people say to them, I want to be a world champion.
Right, right.
But a lot of people don't have what?
But don't have the talent, don't have the discipline, don't have the desire. They don't have all that. It takes everything to make a world champion. And so that summer, I said, when I went back to school as a freshman, I said, I want to be a world champion.
Yeah.
And so although the gym was closed, not having a gym didn't stop me from doing what world champions do. Mm-hmm. World champions run every morning, exercise,
yeah.
and they continue to call themselves a world champion.
Yeah.
And so and people see me, what you running for? What you running for, man? I'm a world champion.
That's right.
And we didn't have a gym.
That's right.
And most of them thought I was crazy.
Yes.
Because our town was real small.
Yes.
And then we had.
And there's Jeff running all over town. I'm a champ of the world champion.
I was from one side of town to another. I'm sorry, long miles. Said, what you doing, man? I'm a world champion, champ.
That sounds like David, doesn't it? Amen. He's out in the field, right?
Yes. Wow. And so went to high school, played football. My freshman, sophomore, junior. As a junior, I got hurt in football. I hurt my knees, and the doctor said, you know what, if you play again, you won't be able to play. If you get hurt again,
yeah.
You miss, you lose your leg. You won't be able to walk. And so at that point, I said, you know what? And then I had a surgery, and the doctor said, you know what, it's going to take a whole year to recover.
Oh.
And so my senior year in high school, I didn't play because the doctor said, if you hit again, then. So my senior year in high school, my friend, I was about to graduate, but I had a friend of mine, he said, Jam, man, I'm going to college. I'm going to basketball, I'm going to Texas, I'm going to college. And because my hometown is very small, very addicted to drugs, and most everybody addicted to drugs, nothing going on, I mean, I gotta go.
Yeah.
I gotta leave here. And all I thought about it, there's no boxing gym. There's no place for me to become a world champion.
Yeah.
So I gotta leave.
Yeah.
And so my friend, he called me one morning and said, I'm going to Rowdy Junior College, man. Mm-hmm. I'm leaving, you wanna come? So I packed all my clothes in my car,
wow.
I had, and I just jumped in the car with the dollar.
Sometimes you gotta go where you grow. Amen.
And so we got to Texas.
The two of you together.
Just two of us together. Right. Got to Texas. That Monday when the school opened up, I spoke to the counselor. She said, look, you can get financial aid. I was like, yeah, it's financial aid.
Yeah.
And so I got financial aid. And that paid for our dormitory in our first and second semester.
Yeah.
And we was in college. It was unbelievable. I mean, all I said was, I wanted to go to college.
Yeah.
I wanted to leave home.
Yeah.
Not knowing that God had already made a way for me to go to college.
Yeah.
All I had to do was go.
All you had to do was go. He already made the way.
All I had to do was go. So, got to college. Man, everything's fine. Two semesters paid for. And so, me and my friend now, like, man, what are we going to do? Tuition's paid this time. We have no more money for tuition because you only get so much tuition.
The financial aid right now.
Financial aid right now. And so, we were looking at going back home.
Yeah.
Was going back home to Louisiana. And so my English professor.
His English professor.
My English professor in college told us a story that Monday, that week before. And it's a story about him when he was an amateur, a young kid, I used to box. And he told us the story, and when he told after the class was over, I said, oh my God, I used to box, man. And I still want to box. And so he said, no, you want to box. I said, I do want to box. And so he took one of his wings and became my English professor. And my training. And this guy took me to Dallas, which was 50 miles from my college, three times a week to train. And he believed in me. We had a conversation, Pastor, and he saw in me what I saw in myself.
Wow. That man sacrificed. Got to put it on his heart. He sacrificed. Somebody didn't even know.
And 2 weeks later, he told me, he said, if you want to fight, you've been training all this time. In Dallas, Texas, there's a Golden Glove tournament.
Oh.
He said, I can only get into the world if you want to fight. I said, I'm fighting.
Yeah.
I'm fighting. That's what I'm here for.
Yeah.
Man, I want to fight. I came to school with football, but I want to box.
Yes.
And so he ended up in the boxing tournament in Dallas. The Golden Gloves, which is a real big, Texas, a big state.
Yeah.
And Golden Glove in Texas is like the biggest.
It's it, yeah.
And so they have this guy, his son had died a couple years before, and he gave away a scholarship to the best fighter of the tournament. And so that, the last night of the tournament, I'm picking up myself, taking my life, just one last fight. They make an announcement. Well, we want to give away this award. And we give away this award every year. We want to give this award to Junior O'Butler, who was the best fighter in the tournament.
That's right. All Texas. And also, you won the Gold Glove.
I won the Gold Glove. Yeah. But the scholarship was $5,000. And that paid for my college. I went to the state of college.
And
I paid for my friends.
And your friends' college.
And we stayed at college. And that next semester, when I was done with college, the same guy that awarded me the scholarship, he called me in his office. He said, Junior, man, I believe you can really become a world champion. He said, if you want to fight, become a boxer, a world champion, I'm going to send you to Arizona. I have a trainer, I have a fight in Arizona, I'm gonna pay all your bills, all you have to do is train full time and eat and train.
Correct.
He said, I'm gonna go to your house, go to Louisiana, tell your mom, ask your mom if you can go, and then call me back and I'm gonna fly up. I said, Paul Persifield, man, I'm going. So I went home, told my mama, said, I'm going to Arizona. Never heard of Arizona before in my life.
That's right.
I said, I'm going to Arizona, man. And so I called Paul, I think I was on a fight in 2 days in Arizona. In June, got to Arizona, had a phenomenal career. But again, my whole goal to come to Arizona was not to be a professional boxer, not to fight on TV, not to drive cars, and my goal was to become a world champion. And I remember in 1996, before I won the title, I was driving Phoenix. I just fought James Toney on national television, riding around with like $20,000 in my pocket. All that time, gold chain, all the stuff that makes you look cool, that makes you look legit, that the world say you need to have to be somebody.
To be somebody, sure.
And so I was driving around, and yeah, this guy named Paul Mooney, he's a pastor this day. He'd always see me when they see me, I was like, man, are you saved? Are you saved, man? He'd always walk and fight. I saw you fight on TV, man, but are you saved? Are you saved, man? And I always had to dodge it, man. I'm like, man, I don't hear that, man. I seen him at every stoplight. I seen him at every gas station. I said, what are you doing here, man? Get to the south side. I said, what are you doing here, man? And this guy said, man, you need to be saved, brother. I said, you're a great guy, man. You're a great fighter. But you're not going to work. You need to be saved, man.
Wow.
And so that, I was at my house driving around. Just fought James Tony in Connecticut. And I was at my house. I was driving. I said, man, God, there has to be more to life than having money. A new car, gold chain, and it got me more.
Yeah.
And I was so depleted. I was so sad.
Yeah.
Went to my house, turned on TV, and saw Larry Kirchhoff on TV.
Oh my goodness.
Talking about the AM, about the athletes.
Yes.
And I went down to McKinnon Street at the Bible study. I got saved in 96.
Oh my God. So, you got saved before you were
champion. And what's funny is that the minute I got saved, I think I saved, I never said I got no more.
Wow.
I never saw him.
Wow.
I just seen him every stoplight.
Wow.
And every day.
Wow. Wow.
And so it was so funny. And so I seen him at the Bible study on Wednesday, right?
Yes.
And he said, hey, man, where you been at? I used to see you all the time, but I hadn't seen him no more.
Oh.
And the good thing is, so Larry joined him, great Bible study on Wednesday, got for me with those guys. Started getting the word in me. I believe I was already a faith guy. I always did believe that what I always did want more. I always did think there was more to my life than what I was getting in Louisiana.
Yeah.
That's why I left to Texas. Because I wanted more, because I believed there was more.
Yes.
And so a year later, after being saved at Tulane, we got a call to fight for the world title here with you. And my trainer was like, brother, man, this is your opportunity. This is your opportunity for the world title. And so we trained for like 8 weeks.
Yeah.
Won the world title peer review, phenomenal win.
Incredible.
And it was right after I got saved.
Yes.
After I got saved.
Yes. Now you were known ultra boxing. You were known for one big thing that it opened up lots of doors for you. And it's because every time you got knocked out.
Right. In boxing, I had a number of big fights on television. I fought before I won the world title. I fought Michael Nunn. I fought a lot of big time guys.
Yeah.
And I was known by all the commentators on television. The one round wonder. I always get knocked down. I got knocked down the first or second round.
First or second round.
So, but that's because my body was trained and prepared to go the distance.
Yeah.
I was prepared. My chin was good.
So you always.
So in the locker room before the fight, while guys are warming up, sweating,
yeah.
I'd be so relaxed. I'd just be sitting down listening to music. Because that's what I do.
Yes.
Boxing is what I do.
Yes.
I ain't got to get hyped to box.
That's right. That's
what I do. And so my trainer, man, my trainer was sitting in the union.
Yeah.
So everybody else sweating, got me, ain't warm up, man, I'm ready.
Wow.
And so when I get in a fight, when I get in the ring, I always get hit, be caught cold,
yeah.
I get knocked down.
Yeah.
But I had a good chin, I always get knocked up. Yeah, yeah. And so after fighting Tommy Hearns, I got knocked down twice by Tommy Hearns. I got back up. I should have beat Tommy Hearns in Detroit. If I'd have fought him in the interstate, I'd have won.
Yeah.
But I fought him in his hometown, Detroit.
Yes.
But we got a call. We got a call from USA Television, and they said, man, we are nominating you in this fight as the best fighter of the month. Because everybody, Tommy Hearns had knocked down in his career. He knocked out. Nobody got knocked out.
Yes. He lost the fight, but he got fighter of the month. Yeah. Because he got back up. Is that awesome?
Yeah, twice. And so, like 2 weeks later, Willie, my trainer, was telling me, man, they give us a title. They're giving you a shot to fight for the world title.
Yeah.
And he said, brother, man, it's not because you're a fourth time, because you got up.
Yeah.
Nobody had ever gotten up from the fight.
That's why he got the title fight. Because he was the guy who always got up.
I got knocked down in like 6-7 fights in the first round. Got up to win them all.
Wow.
Except for one time. Wow.
You said that it's the story of your life.
My life has been about getting up and keep going.
Yes.
And I've had to get up from the very beginning, guys. From the reform school story, high school, the need to in high school.
Yeah.
Going to Texas, I had to get up and go.
Yeah.
I just had to go.
Yes.
Get up and go.
Yes.
And even in Texas, not having the financial aid to continue, I had to get up.
Yes.
And then take the fight.
Yes.
And for the world of love, man.
Yes.
And it doesn't stop me. Life in itself, man. If you're a believer, then you got to fight.
Yes.
Whether you want to fight, whether you know you got to fight, you're in a fight.
Yes.
You're in a fight, guys. Like I told you when we met, man.
Yeah.
What makes a fight a good fight is knowing who you're fighting.
Absolutely.
It's knowing who you're fighting.
Yes.
Man. And one of the scriptures that was very difficult for me to learn as a believer was we wrestle, not against flesh and blood.
Yeah.
But against principalities, powers, and rules of high places. That was very difficult for me. But that scripture built me and helped me overcome a lot of issues and waste a lot of time on petty stuff.
Absolutely.
On petty stuff.
Yes.
Because I realized that it means it's you, but it's something behind you.
Yes.
It's a force behind you that I'm fighting.
Yes.
And so it was a very difficult scripture for learning, I grasped that scripture. I comprehended that scripture. I believed the scripture.
Yes.
And I didn't let petty stuff that people did, or petty stuff that happened, cause me to get me off track.
Absolutely.
From the real purpose.
Absolutely. 2 weeks ago, we talked about getting back up and learning to take some punches. Basically, Christians, we got to learn how to take punches. Last week, we talked about bobbing and weaving, lots of defensive techniques. But then, the next part of it is, what's our weapon?
Right. I mean, the weapon is the Word of God.
Yeah.
I mean, getting back up is important. Getting back up is very important. But when you get up, though, our weapon, you can't just, when I fought Tommy Hearns, I got knocked down, I didn't just get back up. I got back up, I start swimming.
That's right.
Yeah, because if I would have got back up and not throw punches, the referee would say, no, fight is over. Mm-hmm. You got to throw punches. And our weapon, the weapon that we use in this warfare that we fight, this faith fight, is words, the words of God.
Yes.
And that is our weapon.
And you need those words because it reminds you of all God's promises and what God says to do. It reminds your enemy. They were trash talking in the ring. People trash talking. Always.
They always trash talking in the ring. But because, again, guys, and the ring is like home.
Yeah.
In between the four ropes is like home.
It's like home.
Say what you want. At the end of the day, you still, when the bell rings, you gotta come out of there.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. That's right. Yeah, Jeff told me that he said he loves being in the ring so much that even if he was losing a fight, he'd stay in the ring because he just loves being in the ring. It's his home. Well, he loves to be there.
And not only losing, but I had fights with fighters that I was beating, I got knocked out. Really.
Yeah.
But because I love the 3 minutes.
Yeah.
I love going the distance.
Yes.
A lot of guys, I let survive.
You draw out.
I let survive. A lot of guys, I let survive.
That's right.
Just so we go the whole 10 minutes. Because I have to work.
Oh man, that's Cat Bounce.
Yeah,
right?
I love, oh my goodness.
Oh my goodness.
And so.
Tell me about this fight of faith. What do you love about fighting for your faith?
Well, this, the Bible said that we're to fight the good fight of faith.
Yes.
The Bible said that faith comes by hearing,
yeah,
and hearing by the word of God.
Yeah.
And I love this faith because the Bible says that God predestined us and He ordained us. Mm-hmm. He called us. And He preordained, which means before.
Yeah.
He preordained us.
Yeah.
He called us.
Yeah.
And alive. He ordered our steps.
Yes.
Before we was in our mother's womb.
Absolutely.
Which means that it's already done.
It's already done.
It's already done.
Yes.
And so faith is just believing that it's done.
Wow.
That's what faith is.
Yeah, right.
Faith is believing it's done. Not that it's going to happen. But I say that, be it unto you according to what you believe, according to faith.
Yes.
And guys, I just believe it. What I read in the Bible and read.
Yeah.
And I believe that He's done.
Yes, He's done.
And not that He's going to do it, but He's done. Yeah. I remember a time that when I got divorced from my son's mom, who's a great lady, woman of God.
Yeah.
For a while there, I went to the hospital. One night I was scratching the leg. And I couldn't, you know, while I was scratching, but like, it's unbelievable. Yeah. And we lived right next door to the hospital in Phoenix, Maryville.
Okay.
And I went to the doctor and they gave me a physical, all my time. The doctor said, man, you in excellent shape. I just retired. That's what I mean. We're in excellent physical shape. Your vitals, your blood, everything is phenomenal.
Yeah.
And we don't know what's wrong with you. Man, we don't. And at the end, he said, you know what? I can give you some medicine for you to take to help you sleep.
Yeah.
And then the light came on. I know you're not.
Yeah.
Then you're not giving me medicine. Because that's what happened.
Yeah.
The people in the hospital, he misdiagnosed.
Yeah.
Doctors didn't anything from the sleep and the sleep order.
Yeah.
And so I was walking on, I walked to the hospital, the Holy Spirit told me, man, it's depression. It's depression is a silent killer.
Oh my God. It
doesn't make it. It doesn't mean depression is a silent killer. And depression, what happened was my leg was like really see the white meat.
Yeah.
And that was just a manifestation that was going on the inside.
Wow.
And at that time, I couldn't deal with the fact that I was getting divorced. And I wasn't even talking about it, right? And so all this stuff was going on inside of me, and there was no outlet.
Yeah, and so I was sick.
So I went to the doctor. That's why the doctor said, look, I know what's going on, sir. Because he didn't know what was going on inside.
Yeah.
But the Holy Spirit told me, he said, listen, man, it's depression. And he said, and showed me everything, like, why was depression?
Yeah.
What I'm worried about.
Yeah.
And from that moment forward, when I got home, I declare and I pray.
You declare.
I declare.
Yeah.
That's what the word says.
Yeah.
I declare and I pray, and this thing will never happen again.
Yes.
Because the Holy Spirit and God allowed me to identify the problem. What was going on? That it wasn't a natural problem.
Yeah.
The doctor couldn't fix because it was natural.
Yeah.
It was a spiritual problem.
Yeah, spiritual.
Right? It was just a spiritual problem.
Sure.
And when the Holy Spirit revealed it to me, like, you know, look, there's a spiritual problem.
Yeah.
You get so oppression.
Yeah.
It's depression.
Yeah.
Right? And it's from the inside.
Yeah.
It's what you're holding inside.
Yeah.
You gotta let it go.
Right?
You gotta let it go. You gotta forgive her.
Yeah.
Forgive you and let it go.
Yeah.
And that's how I did. You know, I did what I had to. I declared the word. I prayed over her, prayed myself, man, and pastor, and the ups and them, that ain't gonna happen again.
Wash right out of
you. Yes, sir.
Pray for me. Wow. Before you even get into the ring, are you thinking, I'm gonna win? You declare, I'm gonna win this fight.
And guys, this is one thing people say, nothing is guaranteed in boxing. In boxing, every time I got in the ring, before I got in the ring, I declared, man, this is my fight.
Absolutely.
I'm victorious.
You gotta do that with the fights of your life. You gotta declare.
You gotta declare that you're victorious.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. And the Bible says that we can do all things through Christ.
Yes.
And we're victorious because He already fought it with us.
That's right. Yeah.
We're here, right?
Yeah.
And we, if we do our part,
yeah,
is work towards, not work on,
yeah,
or work for,
yeah,
but work towards what we believe.
Yes.
So we're victorious. That's gonna stop us.
Nothing can stop us. No.
Yeah, we're so unstoppable.
Because while that one of you say all the time, you say God's already made a way.
And the Bible said that He prepared, made the crooked places straight.
Yes.
I said, and He ever did.
Yes.
So I said, He, the God has went before us.
Yes.
And made a crooked place straight. Now, myself, I just believe that it's not something that He's going to do, that He has done, but He has done.
Yes, done.
Because the Bible says that Jesus said, it is finished.
Yes.
The word is finished.
That's right.
He's not coming back to do anything else.
That's right.
Everything right. Leaves is that sense.
That's how I'm here. That's how I'm here.
And He got blessed to prepare God as an already God.
Yes.
As a God of already.
Already.
As a God of already.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah, so seeing as God, that He's an awesome God that we serve,
yes,
of, as the God of already.
Already.
Not as the God of will do.
Yes.
Not as the God, no, it's not. Because, I mean, if you're sick in your body, I mean, illness, I don't get sick.
Yeah.
I don't get sick. I don't get nobody else.
Yeah.
None at all. I don't get sick.
Yes.
I caught a cold a year ago.
Yes.
And I tried to say, well, do this, do that. I said, no, I'm doing this way.
Yes.
I'm going to declare the word.
Yes.
Take my rest. Stay asleep.
Yes.
I'm fine.
Yes.
We're ready. So just this week, my upper back.
Oh, man, we both got
a tag. My upper back. I like, what the world? And I was in training, doing my training. Like, wow, really? And so, okay, I know what time it was.
Yes.
I didn't, the Bible said that power and life, death and life is in the power of your tongue.
Yes.
And so whatever words come out of your mouth,
yes,
it goes and creates whatever it is sent out to create.
Yes, yes.
And so, literally, when I felt this agony, pain in my back, I don't believe this, I don't.
Yeah.
But I know the enemy is always easy. The Bible said that He's a thief.
Yes.
He comes to steal, kill, and destroy.
Yeah.
The Bible also says that He crouches at the door.
That's right.
Like, and he crouches,
Yes.
And as soon as He finds a way in, He gets in.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I just went to the Word. I didn't tell Sean. I declared the Word, literally.
Yes.
And I know it was about. It was to keep me, first of all, it was to get me to declare what I felt.
Absolutely.
The Bible says we don't live by sight, we live by faith.
Yeah.
We don't go home, we see. We know what we feel,
yeah,
and the Bible says we live by faith and not by sight.
Yes.
And
yes.
So I know that this was all the, because I felt it,
yeah,
it was facts.
Yeah.
But facts is something to change.
That's right.
Yeah. 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 Facts is something, when you stick with the truth,
yeah,
facts is something to change.
That's
right.
Right.
And literally, I just declared, God bless you, I declared the word of God. I said, the Bible says that because I believe,
yeah,
I can lay my hands up on the sick,
yes,
and it shall recover.
It shall recover.
Not they might recover, but they,
yes,
shall recover.
It shall.
And I laid my hands on my back. When I said that, I said, by His stripes, I'm healed. When I said, I command every tissue, every ligament, every organ, every vein, every artery, every muscle, and my back to function normal in Jesus' name. And Pastor, I'm telling you, I woke up at about 2 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the morning, and my Bible doing this here, trying to feel it.
Yeah.
But no way. The Bible said also, you got to hold fast to confess.
Hold fast, yes.
If it don't happen right then and there, that doesn't mean you're going to see. Pain, this your feeling is, doesn't mean you're not healed.
Yeah.
Just mean you feel it.
Yeah.
Because you're human.
Yes.
You're not dead.
Sure.
That doesn't mean you're not healed.
Yeah.
I mean, really. And so when you declare the word over your life, your body, whatever it is, your general, it's done.
Yeah.
The minute you speak, the Lord says, when you pray, believe. Not after you pray.
Yeah.
Say, when you pray, why you pray? Believe that you receive.
Yes.
And shall be yours.
Yes.
And that's
already.
That's already.
Already.
And that's what, this is already God.
Wow.
Already God. And so we just gotta declare and believe in this God, that the God of already, whether in your finances, already. He said, I provide all your needs.
Yeah.
According to His word.
Yes.
You ain't gotta do nothing for God to provide.
That's right.
Because the Bible says, don't worry. He said, look at the answer of the answer of the field, the birds are there.
Yeah.
Don't worry, no talk. But get up and provide.
Yes.
How much more are you to me than the answer?
Yes, yes.
I mean, how much more are you?
Yes.
God says, I could, you know why? You can rest and have peace, because I already did.
That's right.
Through my son Jesus.
Yes.
But this is the thing. The thing that separates me from a lot of other people is the fact that I believe in a God of already.
Already. Yes.
Not the God that would be.
Yes.
Not the God of already.
Yes.
I believe God has already went before me.
Yes.
And He was quickly straight. I believe that God has already provided all my needs.
Yes.
Really.
Yes.
He told Abraham in several times in scripture, go to this place, go to this mountain, go, and you'll find what you need.
Yes.
And if you don't have it where you're at, then we don't die. He's going to take it where to go.
That's right.
He's already provided.
Yes.
God already provided everything we need, man. from finances to healing to relationships, healing to provide.
Yes.
If it's in the Word, you can find the Word, it's already done.
Yes, absolutely. Yes. It's hard for us to see already when we're going through something that doesn't look like already.
Yes.
But remember that we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Yes. So we have to see in the spiritual realm. Amen?
Yes.
We have to see that God's the God of already. He's already done it. He's already provided it. He's already healed it. Jerry had eye surgery just this week and went in and they sent me a note. I said, God's already got it, didn't I? God's already got it. It's already taken care of. And remember that God doesn't operate according to, you heard him say it, by what we can see.
Right.
But we live by faith. We walk by faith. We operate by faith. Go ahead.
And faith is just simply believing that what Jesus said,
yeah,
he not only said it, but he done it.
Yes, but he's done it.
And
it's finished.
And we are called believers.
Yes.
We're not called figured outers.
That's right.
If that's the word. But we're not called that. We're not called doers.
Yes.
We're called believers.
Yes.
And our job as a body of Christ, as believers,
yeah,
is to believe.
It's to believe.
It's just to believe.
Yes.
Right? It's to believe, man. And so if we can just get that right,
yeah,
and stay in our place, run our own race.
Yes.
And our race to believe.
Yes.
As we go to believe.
You fight your own fight.
Yep. Fight your own
absolutely
fight.
And to win.
Yep. To win.
To win.
Yeah.
Too many Christians, they're running this race and they're not out to win. They just want to survive. And that we don't have to just survive as Christians. God's given us everything that he has, so we're conquerors already. We're overcomers already. And we can, he's made us, if Paul said that we can run the race to win, then we can win. Winning is possible. Winning is there. And the opportunity is there for us.
Jesus said it like this, said, I've come. You guys believe that Jesus came, right?
Yes.
So I said, I've come.
Yeah.
That you may have life,
yes,
and have it more abundantly.
More abundantly.
Not just bare mental life.
Yeah.
Sure. Abundantly. And this is holistic.
Yes.
All areas of life.
Yes.
But have it more abundantly.
Yeah.
And if he said it, then that's what he wants to have.
Yes.
Abundant life.
Yes.
And it's mainly for, and it's not just for us, but for us to share with others, to share the good news of the gospel,
yes,
God's grace and love. And then so that the world will look at our life.
Yeah.
When we look at our life, we see that God is God.
Yes.
He's God alone.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Because the world got a lot to offer.
Yeah.
The world does.
Yeah.
And I tell my son, the world got a lot to offer. And every day, every time you open your eyes, the world is trying to give you something else.
Yes.
Just so you come serve the world.
Yeah.
Not serve God.
Yeah.
I give you money. I give it to you faster.
Yeah.
I give you more. But I have come. Mm-hmm. But you may have life now. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What was the hardest time you ever had to get up in life? You ever got knocked down?
I think the hardest time for me, when I lost my title.
You lost your title?
Yep, when I lost the title. I didn't lose the title. I got stripped from the title.
Yeah.
Me and my manager and my trainer was going through a dispute.
Yeah.
And I didn't want to fight while I was going through the dispute, so I had to wait. And when you're a world champion, you got to defend your title every 6 months.
Yeah.
And the dispute lasted for 6 months, so I got stripped.
Yeah, sure.
And that was tough. That was tough for me because I worked so hard to win the title.
Yes.
And after I had it for like a year,
yeah,
I got stripped from it.
How did you recover from that?
Well,
because if you lost something, listen.
I had the title for 6 months.
Yeah.
And I lost it.
Okay.
And so after I got stripped from the title, man, I got really depressed.
Yeah.
I got sad.
Yeah.
And I'm like, you know what? I'm done boxing.
Yeah.
I'm done boxing. So Emmanuel, my oldest son, saw me fight. And so I used to pick him up, like, oh man, fight again. So I'm done fighting.
Yeah.
I'm done fighting. And so me and me had always played fighting. Dad, I'm the champion. I said, well, I'm going to play a title for you. Mm-hmm. And so I fought for the Arizona State title and won in 2000.
Yeah. So. Incredible. So we're talking from the loss, but I just got to get back in the ring.
I had to get back.
Yeah.
I had to, for myself.
Yeah.
I couldn't let getting stripped beat me.
Yeah.
Defeat me.
Yeah.
Because that's just an issue of life.
Yeah.
Yeah, the box is on. It's the issue of life. Issue of life come.
Yes.
So you can't let the issue of life defeat you.
Yeah.
Right? It's the issue of life. You know?
Now, Jeb, when you're in the ring, what are you thinking about when you're fighting? I mean, your training's done. You're training into the fight. What are you thinking about? What are you looking at?
Well, I tell you what, when I fight somebody, yeah. I'm looking at them in the eyes.
In the eyes.
Dead, looking at
them. Okay.
And so, and my thought process is to weigh you down.
Yes.
The whole time.
It just outlasts you.
Yep.
It just outlasts you.
Really,
yes.
It's to throw so many punches.
Yeah.
And being your face so much was that you say, I can't. Mm-hmm. And I've got guys just throwing us out. I've got trainers to throw us out on guys.
Oh my
God.
He said,
I can't.
Yes.
That's my.
They just can't keep going.
Can't keep going.
Wow.
Can't keep up with the pace.
You know, I tell people all the time that the key to, well, Pastor, the devil's attacking me and I'm dealing with this and all the hell's after me. And I tell them the key is, well, you know, you got to outlast the devil.
Yes, you do.
So many people give up and they quit too soon. And it's really because we haven't built that endurance in us. We haven't trained. We get into the fight where we're in the ring with the devil, and then we run to church. You out there get some training. Well, you should have been in church before the fight started, amen? Because you got to train yourself. You got to build yourself up. They didn't just throw Jeff in the ring and say, okay, now. And he trained for everything. That's why people, you guys say to me the other day, well, you know, church really isn't an important thing. And I said, well, you know what? It's not there necessarily to get you to heaven. Your relationship with the church isn't going to get you to heaven. Jesus, it's your relationship with Jesus. Is that
right?
But the church is going to train you. It's going to train you for life, train you to endure, train you to keep moving forward, and train you God's word, and train you in your faith, and train you in your spirit. And it's an important thing because you're going to get through everything that you're going to get through everything if you just outlast what you're going through.
Wow.
It will. Because your trial will end. All of our trials have an expiration date. Did you know that? Every single trial has an expiration date. And if you just outlast it. And so Jeff got in the ring. He was so trained up, and he learned to endure. His endurance is his whole life, even now. It's his whole life and ministry and business. And he trained himself to just outlast every other ring.
And this is, for me, endurance because I believe I win.
Yeah.
Because I don't quit.
Yes.
If I set a goal, and if I don't reach my goal, yeah. It's not over.
Yes, yes.
It's not over if I reach my goal.
Yes.
We have set out to do something in the business,
yeah.
In the life, my sons, in college, and in careers.
Yeah.
Man, it ain't over till we win.
Yes, yes.
You don't settle for it. Well, it must not have been God's will. No, there's no.
Yeah.
The devil's a lie.
When you know God's put a dream inside of you, you don't quit.
Yes.
You keep going. I tell the story all the time that when I started out as I was an evangelist. I was traveling on the road, and I'd get introduced at this big pastor's conference with 8,000 pastors. My first year, there were 87 of us on stage, all lined up, all going to travel out in ministry. And by the 10th year, there were three of us left. And people say, well, what was the secret? I'm just too dumb to quit. I just believe in what God told me to do, and I've got faith, and I'm just going to keep going, keep going, keep going. There are 100 times I could have quit this whole church business, or could have gone and done something in the world and made a whole bunch of money, or taken a position somewhere in music and done a lot of things. But I know above everything else that God called me to do this. And so I just don't quit. I just don't quit. I'll be here. And I'll be here. I'll fall over. I'll fall over on the end of the pulpit. Just carry me out.
The Bible says that God is no respecter of persons.
Yes.
And if you've done it for him, then he's done it for you.
Yes.
He did it for you as well.
Yes.
So if you've done it for me, then he also done it for
That's
you.
Right.
Yeah.
He's no respecter of
you.
If you did it in Jeff's life for him, gets up over and over and over again, God will do it for you also.
Yeah.
You can get up.
Yeah.
You can.
Every time.
Yeah.
And so the difference between if you don't make it, it's because you didn't get up.
Yes.
You didn't get up.
Yes.
Yeah,
you didn't get up, you go. That's it.
Yeah,
so. Well, what would you say to everybody right now? What does Jesus mean to your life?
What Jesus is the foundation. If it would not have been for me being introduced to Jesus in 96, my life would not for sure not be what it is. I have no way I would have been. Jesus saved me. Went through this terrible divorce. Went through this upside down in my career. Went through a long period of time being lonely, single.
Yeah.
Jesus comforted me. He is the comfort.
He's the comfort.
Jesus is the peace. He is that.
Yes.
The Bible says, he asked Peter somewhere, who do you say that I am?
Yes.
I can say that Jesus is that to me.
Yes. Yes.
He is my provider.
Yes.
He is El Shaddai to me.
Yes.
Because he's been all that to me.
Yeah.
And so he is my own.
Yes.
He is my rock. So when I talk to Jesus, I'm talking to you.
Yes.
That's it.
Yes.
And my buddy.
Yes.
My buddy. He is.
He is.
And so we're close. We're close.
He's with you all the time.
Always.
He's, but he said a very important thing. He's the foundation. Jeff's foundation for his whole life.
Right.
And that's why he's been able to keep going. He's been able to get back up and get back into the ring again. Get back in the ring of life again.
Right.
And he's got a world's most beautiful fiance sitting right on there, Shawnee. They've been together a year, and God's just doing incredible things in their lives. They're studying the Word together, they're growing together, and doing this business together. And when Jesus is the foundation, in other words, everything's built on top of that. He's the cornerstone. And the Word says that the world rejected Jesus. They rejected that cornerstone. But it's the cornerstone for your life, the foundation for your life, and you can build everything else. But it's got to be on top of Him, right?
That was definitely.
Yeah.
This is what we experience at this church. And when other people in the world can experience this through other churches and other people, then the kingdom of God will advance.
Yes.
The Bible said that the world will know that we're God's disciples.
Yes.
By the love we show
them. By the love we show them.
And then I can honestly say that from the minute I walked with you on the property, love has been demonstrated.
Mm-hmm.
Love and Shawnee and I, and love. And so when people receive it, give that voluntarily.
Yes.
Not forcefully, voluntarily.
Yes.
I love you.
Yes.
And the world will know that we're his disciples.
Yes.
When we're able to love those that hurt us, those that we know currently mistreat us, talking about us. We have to still love them, man.
Yeah, we don't still like them.
Yeah, we gotta like them. We gotta love them.
Yes.
That's when the world's gonna love them. Yep.
Absolutely.
It's not really just loving each other, loving those that love us.
Yeah.
But we can love those that don't love us.
That's right.
Love those that we know talking about us.
Yes.
Love those that we know mistreat us.
Yes.
We can love them, not just privately, but love them corporately.
Yeah.
In front of the world, in front of others.
Because
it's hard to love people that you know don't like you,
yes.
In front of people.
Yes.
That know they don't like you.
Yes, that's right.
When we can deny ourselves, take our cross, and do like Jesus did.
Yeah.
And love in spite of.
Yes.
And the Bible says that Jesus went a little further.
Yes.
To the cross.
But
we can go a little further.
Yes.
And our love, man, and go push beyond ourselves.
It's just
and love a little further.
We need to learn to love further. We need to learn to love beyond these doors. Amen.
Yes.
Beyond these walls, beyond the edge of the property. And we didn't, Jesus said anybody could love people that like you.
Right.
I mean, that's easy. He said, go on, man. Love your enemies and do good to those who curse you and pray for them and love them. You know, you've had the whole world against you all your life, haven't you?
Yeah.
Everything. It's been a battle.
Mm-hmm.
And Saint, my son, he's over the beach today. He's 9 years old. And we were driving to church today, and I've been talking to him about you and about all that you've been through. Every time we meet, I'm going, oh, St. Jeff went through this and all. You know, going. So we're driving to church today. He goes, Dad, he goes, this is the funniest thing to hear out of a 9-year-old's voice. He goes, Dad, you told me Jeff's story. And he goes, how come all these successful people have such a terrible backstory?
Oh,
backstory. Where do you even learn to say backstory? I said, you know why I'm saying that? I said, they've found it in all these studies that people that have the most difficult beginnings of life, what they learn is they learn to endure. They learn endurance. They learn to trust God and just keep going and keep enduring it. How'd you make it through every battle from a kid?
Well,
you know, Dad, Mom, Morgan, Hart, brothers and sisters, everybody telling you couldn't do it, running around the neighborhood, running all over town, people laughing at you. How'd you do it?
Well, let me just say something.
Yeah.
Your son.
Sure, go ahead.
Success doesn't come easy.
Yes.
Not only success, but let me just say it this way. The will of God does not happen automatically.
Yes.
And so you say the son has, well, how come all these successful people have such a struggle life?
Yeah.
Because you got to fight.
Yes.
If it was easy, everybody would be on TV.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's right, everybody.
So, I mean, everybody would be doing TV shows and movie shows.
Yes.
Good. Because that's what people want to do.
Yeah.
But they can do it.
Yeah.
Or people are doing their dream.
Sure.
Everybody be doing it. It ain't easy.
No.
It's not easy. And so it doesn't happen automatically. So we got to fight. God says fight, press your way.
Yeah.
Got to press our way, man.
Yeah.
Got to fight. We got to endure.
And if it comes easy, you'll never learn to fight. You'll never learn to endure. Be patient.
You never learn to endure. And then when you get it, you want to appreciate it.
Yeah.
You want to appreciate it.
Yeah.
You know, what you want to share with us is how you got it.
Yeah.
But it's the story behind it.
Yeah.
It's the story behind it. how you got it, what you had to go through, man,
yeah.
that can help somebody else.
Absolutely.
I can help somebody else trying to get what you're trying to get.
Yeah.
Trying to be what you once were.
Absolutely.
That's what it is.
You kept your focus, you kept your focus, you kept your focus, you kept your focus. And then the pastor told you, you gotta get saved.
Right.
And that was the turning point for...
Well, he told me, I didn't say, but this was the turning point, Pastor. After I came back from fighting James Tony in Connecticut,
yeah.
me riding around Arizona, again, at that time, it was 1996. Man, at that time, couldn't call.
You got everything.
Got everything.
Yeah.
I thought that
yeah.
I wanted.
Yeah.
I would need it.
Yeah.
Right? And me riding around, and I said, what the world? Literally, it's a 12 o'clock in the afternoon.
Sure.
It's hot in Arizona.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, this sucks.
Yeah.
But I said, this sucks. This sucks. Man.
That's right.
And I literally said, I was driving out of God. It has to be more to life
yeah.
than having this stuff and just.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And well, I literally went home and said, "There, God said, there is more to life. Here it is, Larry Kirchak.
Here it is. Yes.
I'm going to introduce you to what's more to life.
Yes. Yes.
Here it is, man." And so I was so happy. I was so happy.
Incredible. There's more to life. And you know, beware, because I've got some pastor friends up, and they'll be on posting. You know, they just bought some new diamond rings, or they bought some new necklaces and all, and they're promoting that instead of promoting Jesus. And I'm not judging them at all. I'm just saying that that's not the kind of example that I want to set for people. People weren't drawn to Jesus because he was rich.
Right.
And in fact, he said, I don't need your money. I don't need your stuff. He said, I just want you. And I want to encourage you that if you really want to experience everything that God has for you, God says it all starts with one person, Jesus. It all starts there. He's the foundation for everything else. God's not about you getting wealth. God's not about you having fancy cars and money and all. And if you got them, God bless you. God doesn't mind you having nice stuff. But it's about Jesus. Our church is about you really knowing Jesus and learning to serve Him and love Him and follow Him. And that's what we're about. That's why we're so unpopular. Amen? We're going to pray in a minute, but I want to tell you something very special that Jeb and I, we've met multiple times over the last few weeks. And what you don't know about Jeb is that he's a licensed minister of the gospel. And he's a minister. He's a man of God. He's a reverend. Amen? Reverend River Boxer. Amen? And he's using his life. He's got a new thing called Jeb Boxercise. Well, it's not new, but anyway, they're going to be doing commercials on television, all sorts of things, that have doors that have opened up from just miracles. And he's training kids to be healthy and training adults to be healthy. And another thing opened up in Scottsdale for him the other day. But he called me a week and a half ago and he said, can we please go and sit down? And we sat down and he said, look, he said, I've been praying a prayer for a long time. He said, I've been in the church and I've been faithful to that church. He said, but I've been praying for a place that I would just be loved, where I would feel loved, accept God's love. And he said, so Pastor, he goes, I want you to pray about it. I want to know if you'd accept it, if I come. Come to your church and come under your ministry and join your church. And so I told him, well, I'll have to think about it for a while. So he and Shawnee are our two brand new members. They're our newest members. We got ideas and we got plans and he wants to teach the word. He wants to do a whole bunch of stuff. And so there's going to be in the next couple weeks you're going to hear about new things that are going to be coming up and that Jeb's going to do. And that's my big announcement for today. We're so excited to tell you all. And yet, I've been praying for more hands, for more help, to lift more people up, to lift Jesus up, and to love more people. And God's been sending him. Stan and Carol, who got called away on business, and God sent them in. Larry and Wendy. Larry, that he's heard him talk about, I've known Larry since 1992, and you've known him since 1996, right? And I was going to do this boxing video, and I thought, well, I'll ask Larry. He knows all the athletes. And Larry immediately responded, you got to call this guy Jeb Butler, you know, Earl Butler. He always calls you Earl, Junior Earl Butler. He said, call him up. And I called him. He said, absolutely, Pastor, I'll do anything that you want me to do. Tell me what to do. I'll be there. What do I need to be there? Tell me. And God, we just feel God really ordained this and put this all together. And so I'm very excited about it. Let's bow your heads with me, will you? Bow your heads and close your eyes for a minute. I want you to look in your heart. And it's a very special day. And I'll tell you why. Because every time you have an opportunity to embrace more of Jesus, it's a special day. If you're here today, and you've been struggling, you've been knocked down, you've been bobbing and weaving your way through life, maybe you've been bobbing and weaving from Jesus, man. You, like Jeff did, you've been just kind of, you know, you keep hearing, you keep seeing Jesus in some form all over town, and you're bobbing and weaving, trying to duck what you know God wants to do. And God's got more for you. God's got bigger things for you, bigger plans for you, bigger dreams for you. Everything, everything. I mean, don't think that everything that God's already done in your life is it. God says, His Word says, He takes us from glory to glory to glory. And God always wants us to step up another step. And if you're here today, maybe you've been bobbing and weeping from God, what you know He wants you to do. Today, maybe you want to say to God, God, I surrender today. Jesus, I hear you loud and clear. I know what you want me to do. I need to commit. I need to be consistent. I need to be all in. I need to make you my foundation. Jesus, I'm going to build my whole life upon you. I'm going to know you like I've never known you before. I'm all in, Jesus. Maybe you're struggling with illness. You're struggling with challenges, family, battle, finances, whatever it is. God is the God of already. Already. He's already done. He's already made a way. He's already made the crooked paths straight. Jesus said, it's finished. He's already done. If you're here today, I want to encourage you to tell God, God, I'm sorry that I've been negative. I'm sorry that I've been by myself to be depressed. I've been in this flesh. Sometimes this flesh gets depressed. But today, Jesus, I see your word and your truth. I've learned the defense. I've learned how to dodge the punches. I've learned how to take a few. But today, I'm going to learn to stand on your word. And I'm not just on defense anymore, but I got a good offense. And that's the word of God. Jesus, I stand on your word. It's already done. My miracle's already there. God, you've already made a way. I just need to walk in it. It's already there. So I need to get up and go. I need to get up and step in that way. I need to get into that way. Get into that flow. And so I commit that to you today, Jesus. I'm going to make you the foundation of all my life. Everything that I am. And if you're here today, you've never asked him to come in and live in your heart. It'll be like for Jeff, be the greatest decision you ever made. Like for me, I made the decision myself. 1979. Today, if you want to say, Jesus, I open up my heart and I want you to come in. Forgive me of all my sins. I'm going to pray a prayer right now. And you can pray this prayer after me. I'm going to ask everybody here to repeat this prayer after me. To encourage those who might want to truly pray it with a sincere heart. But Jesus, God's Son, wants to come in, forgive you, and make you brand new inside. Everything brand new, your life brand new, and your plans brand new, and brand new blessings and promises. But most of all, Jesus wants to come in and be your brand new, greatest friend you ever had in your life. And love you and hold you and embrace you and care for you and give you his wisdom and his knowledge. And the Holy Spirit to come in and empower you and comfort you and give you peace. And so if you want that, I'm going to pray a prayer right now. Repeat it after me. You want to pray right now. Everybody else say it after me. Jesus, I open up my heart. Come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. Son of God, I release myself. I surrender. Be my best friend. My constant. Closer than a brother. My comfort, my peace, my strength, my redeemer, my master. Take over my life and create a brand new me. I don't need anything else but you. And I know that as I trust you, you'll provide everything else. Thank you, Jesus, for coming in my heart. Now thank you right now. Like you thank your best friend somebody did for you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you for coming in. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Oh, Jesus. Thank you for coming in. Now look at me for just a moment. If you're visiting here today, we welcome you. If you don't have a church home, we'd love to have you join us. I'll take you as far with God as you want to go. That's one great ability I believe that I have, is that I can take people long, long ways, all the way with God. But you got to be willing. You got to be committed. You've got to be consistent. Consistency is key. Amen? Amen. And you got to say, Pastor, I'm all into this. And I'll go as far as we need to go, whatever we need to do. And it'll take you all the way. And God has so many great plans for your life. And he says plans to prosper you, plans not to harm you, but to give you hope and to give you a future. Who wants a hope in the future? We have it all in Jesus. And so I want to encourage you, if you'd like to join us, you can fill out your connection card on the back of the card. First time jumper, second time. If you want to turn it over, you want some information about join the choir. We got a new girl join the choir today. Awesome. And the fellow who's just waiting for her knee to get a little stronger, she's joining the choir. And God's doing just so many beautiful things. So fill it out, and you can put it in the offering basket when it comes by. But ushers, would you get ready to take up our morning time and offering? And let's give to God today. Amen. Who loves to give to God? And I want you to